Good morning, guys. We're back at it again with another video. What is going on? There is no concrete down. I know in the last video I said that today was the day, Thursday, that we're going to be getting the pour for the slab here. But as you can see, there's nothing. The contractor that's doing the formwork, that's doing the rebar and doing the concrete pour, called me up yesterday, and the pump truck that they scheduled to come today, there's an issue with it. So we have to reschedule the pour for either Monday or Tuesday next week. And this is one of the things, this is a good lesson, is especially with construction, you know, I was in the industry for about 5 years, and you can plan everything out as perfectly as you can, and sometimes there are unforeseen circumstances that can kind of throw your plan out the window. So it's a good time to practice patience and be like, everything is going to happen as it should. So instead of doing an update on the garage today, I wanted to update you on our rainwater harvesting system and whether or not we're running out of water. So a lot of people, especially that live in this area, they've been very curious about how our system has been working, because a lot of people know out here that we're completely on rainwater and we live in the desert. So we only get, in this area, we only get about 11 or 12 inches of rain per year. And yeah, you can certainly do some, you can do some rainwater harvesting. And I think in an area like this, it's even more important to do rainwater harvesting. So let me go show you the tanks, show you where we're at. And yeah, I think you'll be pleasantly surprised by how much water that we actually do have. So a quick overview of our system. I built this gargantuan rain roof. So it's 72 feet long by about 40 feet going up the slope there, and it gravity feeds into our main water collection tanks. I have a playlist of videos where I show how I built the rain roof and how the entire system is set up. So you can check out that playlist right up there. But from an elevation standpoint, where the gutter is on the rain roof, from an elevation standpoint, it's about 2 feet higher than the top of the tanks there. So that is how this system is able to work through gravity quite easily. So we have 2 4-inch pipes coming from the rain roof. They're trenched underground, and then they go into the in our first main collection tank right there. And what this system is called is it's called a wet system. So those two pipes right now are actually filled with water. So as water trickles down the rain roof, goes into the gutter, it displaces that water at the top there and then pushes it into the tanks right down here. So those 2 4-inch pipes right there are filled with water. So if we lived in an area where we had really prolonged periods of freezing temperatures, I'd have to drain the water out of those pipes there just so that they didn't, you know, burst them. Even though this isn't really applicable for me, but it might be applicable for your area, is that I installed 2 cleanouts down at the bottom here so that if I ever wanted to empty the water in these pipes, especially the pipes that are underground going all the way up to the rain roof, I could just easily open up those cleanouts. And then I can drain the water. So a very quick way of figuring out how much a roof catchment surface, how much water it's gonna collect over the course of a year, is you take the square footage of that, so it's about 2,900 square feet, you multiply it by 0.62. I think that's the coefficient if you're using like a metal roof. So you multiply that by 0.62, and then you multiply it by how many inches of rain that you get per year. So we get about 11 inches of rain. So that rain roof theoretically is going to capture around 20,000 gallons of water per year. You'll also notice with this system is that we don't have a first flush. So this main collection tank here acts as our first flush. So as the water in this tank fills all the way up, the water will then be transferred across this pipe into this tank, which this tank, that one there, and then the one behind me there, they're all interconnected below. So as this water tank starts to fill up, it'll disperse the water evenly between these three back here. So to give you an idea of how much water we had last August after our last series of monsoon rains, all 4 of these tanks were completely filled. So there's 10,000 gallons of capacity. I was also able to fill that tank up there as well. So that's an extra 1,500 gallons. So we had 11,500 gallons of water between these 5 tanks. So in our main collection tank here, this one is completely empty. Let's see how much water is in here. You might be able to see it, but there's just a tiny amount of water at the bottom. There might be about 200 or 300 gallons. Coming up to the third one here, So you can see the water level here, right at the top. So there's about 2,500 gallons of water in this tank. Coming up to the fourth tank here, boom. It's right at the top. I already emptied the water out of that tank there, so it's completely empty. So this culvert cistern tank was installed after the monsoons that we had last year, so it doesn't really have any water in it. It's basically empty. On our other culvert cistern that captures water from the tiny house roof and the awning roof, I thought this tank was empty. But when I opened it up today, it's completely filled. So this is another about 1,600 gallons of water in this tank right here. Booyah! So you know what that means, is we have made it the entire year completely on rainwater in the desert here. So I figured that our monthly usage is around 1,000 to 1,200 gallons per month. So with over 6,000 gallons of water stored right now, we only have to make another 6 weeks until we get to our monsoon rains. So they typically start in our area right at the, typically in the last week of July, and they go for about 3 weeks into August. And once the gods start pouring down rain even more, these tanks are gonna get filled up pretty quickly. We have a water meter here installed so that I could just see how much we're actually using throughout the entire year. So last year, May 9th, 2017, the meter read 4,700 gallons. So if we look at it right now, it's kind of hard for you guys to see, but we're at 16,100 gallons. So that basically means from May of last year till June of this year, about 13 months, we've used, what is that? I gotta get my calculator out here. So that means in about 13 months, we've used around 11,400 gallons of water. Now, Hannah and I, we're not like super conservative with water. Like we take like nice, decent showers, like at least 5 or 6 minutes, I'd say. So we're not really restrictive with our water use. Over the course of the last year, I'd say that we've probably been away from our home. I'd say for at least 4 weeks to 5 weeks of time. So instead of saying that it's been 13 months of usage, realistically, it's only been about 12 months of usage. Even while we're away, we still have water going to our garden and all that kind of stuff. So we're still using some water while we're not here, but we're not obviously using as much as we would have if we're taking showers and doing dishes and all that kind of stuff. Dougie, that means that we made it, buddy. We made it the entire year on rainwater. Dougie's a little kitten that we adopted from Off-Grid with Doug and Stacy. Are you hot, buddy? It is hot out here. It's getting up to 100 degrees now. Okay, you can go inside. How satisfying is that? We made it through the entire year with most of our rain. So most of the water in those tanks is actually the water that we captured from the last monsoon season. We did get about, during the winter rains, we got a little bit less than I originally thought. We only got about 2,000 gallons of water during the winter season. So of those, of that total 6,600 gallons of water, over 4,000 of it is stored water that we got from the last monsoons. So with just taking a little bit of time and doing a little bit of basic math and designing things properly, yeah, rainwater harvesting, completely living on rainwater in the desert, in this desert climate, can certainly be done. So this is a really good lesson, and it ties into my last video talking about micro wind turbines and how I don't think they are for most people. Like I said, for most people, I didn't say every single application, they're not useful. They are useful in certain applications. But for most people, if you're wanting to do solar and you don't get a ton of sun like we do in Arizona, that just means you have to upsize your system a little bit. It doesn't mean that you can't do solar in a climate where you don't get, you know, 300 days of sun like we get here. At the same time, if I lived, say, where Off-Grid and Doug and Stacy live, and I think they get at least 30, 40 inches of rain per year, Doug only has one main water collection tank that is 3,000 gallons. So we have total about 14,000 gallons of capacity for our rainwater harvesting tanks. So that means we just have to be a little bit more creative with how we design our system. So while you may live in an area where you don't get a ton of sun as much as we do, we don't get nearly as much rain as you do. So every area that you live is gonna pose different problems to solve. I wouldn't say issues, I would say problems to solve. That's a much better way of perceiving the situation. You wanna think of it as a problem to solve. And probably the biggest consideration that you wanna take when you're designing either a rainwater harvesting system or a solar system is your usage. So we don't use a ton of water compared to most residential households. We don't have a flush toilet, which I believe equals typically around 30 to 40% of a household's domestic water usage is the water that is used for the toilet. And also irrigation is a big part of that as well. But just doing dishes, doing laundry, taking showers. I don't take a shower every single day, but usually every other day I take a shower. So if we're kind of mindful of how much we're using, especially with solar power, I mean, that's how you really can design a system that is going to fit your needs. Somebody was curious about how much the rain roof costs. I think in materials just for the rain roof itself was around $2,000, and I've probably invested around $10,000, maybe $11,000 in the poly tanks as well as in the culvert cistern tanks. And one of the great things about rainwater is how pure the water is. Even though the water is very pure and distilled because it's rainwater, I still put a small amount of bleach in the rainwater tanks when they get filled up. And that's just to keep down any growth of any nasties in there. All the water going into the house is filtered through two whole house cartridges. And then any water that we use for drinking or for cooking goes through the Berkey filter. So the water that we have here, even Hannah's commented on it, is that when she tastes the water from somewhere else that we go, the water tastes really funny to us because we're used to drinking this really clean, pure rainwater that just tastes phenomenal. I remember that we got a quote for a well when we first moved out here. It was gonna be around $15,000. So we did save some money on the well by just doing rainwater. And I think in the future we might drill a well if we wanna do a whole bunch of fruit trees. That's really where doing rainwater harvesting in the desert can kind of be a bit of a struggle, is because if you're gonna be growing certain fruit trees that aren't native to the area, they require a tremendous amount of water. It's like, it depends obviously on the size of it, but once certain trees get fully matured, you know, they may require 4,000 to 5,000 gallons of water per year. So that's one reason why, if you get any of the books that I recommend by Brad Lancaster about rainwater harvesting for dry lands, is he mentions to only really be planting native trees in the area, because that's gonna really reduce how much water that you're gonna be using. All the water that does come from our shower, that comes from our washing machine, that comes from our sink, it goes out back into the landscape as gray water, and it grows fruit trees for us. So if you do wanna be growing fruit trees, using your gray water is a great way of doing it. Our mulberry tree, we've been picking mulberries off of it quite a bit already this year. They taste awesome. The tree is going bananas right now. It's our best growing tree. And it just gets all the water from the washing machine. So you can utilize that water, put it back into the landscape to grow food for yourself. I did write an article on DIY homestead projects, specifically about the rain roof, but I also included a lot of photos of the construction of it. So if you wanna check that out, learn more about our rainwater harvesting system, I'll leave a link down in the description box below and you can check it out. Awesome guys, thanks so much for watching. Oh yeah, by the way, I'm going to be speaking at the Homesteading Life Conference in Hannibal, Missouri, August 12th to 13th, 2018. It's going to be an awesome event. If any of you guys are planning to come, send me an email, Derek@DIYHomesteadProjects. Maybe we can do lunch together or dinner together one of the nights that I'm going to be there. I'm going to be there for you guys to answer questions. We can talk about small business type stuff. Anything that you guys are curious about, I'm there for you. Awesome. Thanks so much for watching, guys. I'll catch you on the next video. Talk to you soon. Peace.